Hey guys, today we're going to look at this ancient Hindu temple called Preah Vihear in Cambodia. And we see there's this insane amount of rocks piled everywhere. These blocks were once a part of this 1,000-year-old temple, but due to a war between Thailand and Cambodia, most of the temple has been destroyed. But these dismantled blocks show us some very interesting insights about ancient rock cutting technology. Look at the amount of cuts you see on these stone blocks. There are so many sizes and shapes. There are square slots or cube-like cuts. There are circular holes. Look at these perfect circular holes drilled in. How was this possible 1,000 years ago? And here you can see this T-shaped cut carved at one of the edges of this stone block. What could have been the purpose of this? Maybe liquid metal was poured into it to clamp it to its neighboring block. This is commonly known as Keystone Cut or ancient metal clamping technology. We can put two blocks side by side with T-shaped cuts and then pour molten metal into them, and they will become inseparable as the metal solidifies to become a clamp. It's also possible that this is a female slot, and the neighboring block was set up with a T-like male projection, so they both could fit perfectly. All these fittings are on the inside of the blocks of the walls. This is why we do not see them on the outside. On the outside, if you see the walls, you do not see details like this. Here, you see something very interesting, a small wedge-like stone block placed inside. This is a very interesting technology employed in this temple. What is the purpose of this? Normally, you would think the builders accidentally left a hole and later they covered it up with a small block. But ancient builders of Cambodia were master stonemasons. Remember, I already showed you how they assembled stone blocks of various sizes with ease, and you don't see any joints, even in corner blocks. Let's look at another example. Here, again, you see a small wedge-shaped stone plugged in. What is the secret behind this? Inside, there must be an interlocking system with holes, and this wedge actually works as a dowel or a fastener, which goes through all the holes set up inside. Today, carpenters use dowels to fasten multiple blocks, but you can see how ancient Cambodians used the same technology 1,000 years ago. Actually, this is not limited to ancient Cambodia. Ancient Indians, Incas, and Mayas also used the same technology. Look at this stone block wall from Peru. You can see this small dowel plugged in, which will fasten all these surrounding blocks together. But the real question is, why is this needed? Why can't they just assemble all the blocks with perfect fits without this dowel? Here's where ancient builders show us their genius. Imagine you had to disassemble the wall. Imagine you have to dismantle some of the blocks. With dowel technology, all you have to do is remove the dowel and all the blocks would loosen up and can be dismantled easily. Without the dowel, if everything was tightly fit, you have to start removing each and every block, starting from the top of the wall. This is why ancient builders used these dowels. This dowel technology is especially required for complicated polygonal stone masonry. Most of the stone blocks are not rectangular, they're polygonal, and such dowel technology becomes mandatory to facilitate easy dismantling. And you may think, I don't see any dowels in this wall. Well, dowels are usually visible on the other side, and the dowels would be visible on the other side of this wall as well. Look at this stone block. It has a total of 8 edges in 2D. It can be used like a rocking chair, but it's made of one piece. It reminds me of the monolithic rocking chairs found in Coral Castle in the United States. Believe it or not, this is one of the simpler designs found in Preah Vihear temple. Let me find something more complex. Now look at this stone, for example, right? So here's the end of the stone. If you go all the way here, right? Here you can see it turns at right angle. So here's the corner, but it doesn't end there. It curves. It curves, and then it goes here. Again, it doesn't end there, it keeps on going. Again, it curves, and then again, it's there. So this is the most complex design, and we don't even see the end of the stone because it's incorporated into this 900-year-old temple. This is extraordinary. Imagine having many blocks interlocked. Without the dowel, it would be impossible to dismantle them. The construction techniques of ancient Hindus are always mesmerizing. Historians and archaeologists insist that ancient kings employed thousands of slaves and whipped them to create this kind of stonework. But what we see here does not fit this theory. It's so easy to build a column with normal square blocks on top of one another. But no, ancient builders had absolute fun making it like this. These must have been as easy as using Lego blocks for them. So even when the modern day quote-unquote civilized people destroyed some blocks, the column is still standing. And on the ground, partially buried, is something priceless. Yes, it is an example of ancient machining technology. A column is buried. In Preah Vihear temple, there are hundreds of such columns. Most of them adorn the large windows in the walls. I have already explained how such columns are impossible to create without a lathe mechanism. So this proves that ancient people were using machining technology. But there are hidden meanings in these columns. Some say these 7 columns represent the 7 days of a week. These perfectly machined columns create a strange shadow pattern. Is it possible you can tell the time and day using these columns? Curious, I explore another area, and again, I stumble on a window with 7 columns. This causes 7 different shadows and the light splits into 7 beams. But this is beyond my understanding. There's some kind of hidden meaning. Some windows have 3 columns, some have 5, and some have 7 columns. And look at how the columns are fit to the top and bottom of the window frame. They are so perfect. Some experts claim that this entire window and the columns were carved out of one stone block. But such a design is impossible, and it would be too complicated even today, because the window frames have to be cut with a straight through mechanism, and the columns have to be cut with rotating mechanism. I walk around trying to find out more about this, and I stumble on something interesting. Here's a hole in the window where a column would have been placed. Look at it. This is a perfect circular hole drilled 1,000 years ago. And the column is missing. This proves that columns were machined separately and later placed into the window frame one by one. But the alignment is so perfect, experts find it hard to believe that these are individual pieces put together. Even more interesting, it is said that originally these columns rotated and produced a ringing sound. I've shown you some ringing rocks in India, but this is some strange legend. I've never seen a rotating rock create a ringing sound. In Western countries, these machined artifacts would have been protected in museums. But in Cambodia, many of these priceless columns are found on the ground. They were torn down because of the war between Thailand and Cambodia. War is a terrible thing. It makes people destroy even the most incredible ancient sites. In the last few decades, the temple was altered by soldiers. This bunker was built and was used as a makeshift hospital to treat the wounded soldiers. You can see concrete structures built alongside the ancient blocks. The original structures have been removed. But these minor alterations are nothing. The temples themselves have been demolished, mostly because of the war. This is the topmost temple, the main temple, and from the aerial view, you can see a huge amount of debris strewn around. Locals say this is because of the bombs dropped by Thai forces. The amount of destruction you see is shocking. The blocks which were once precisely cut and assembled are now in ruins. Modern humans are primitive and destructive people, while ancient builders were quite advanced and constructive. Let's go inside the main chamber and see what's inside. At least the central chamber is partially intact, and I'm eager to see what I will lay my eyes on. As I walk inside the chamber, I realize there's something missing. Something is wrong. It does not feel right. Inside, we see a beautiful Ganesha statue, the popular elephant god of India. I give my prayers, but the vibration is wrong. The pyramidal structure on the top is nearly intact, and even though most Cambodians have converted from Hinduism to Buddhism now, they've been gracious enough to set up a Hindu deity in the chamber. Yes, now I realize that this is a new statue. This is not the original one, which was set up in ancient times. Remember, I told you the inscriptions in the temple mention a deity called Shikareswara. Originally, a lingam which looked like Mount Kailash was in this place, and now it's gone. Near the entrance, there's a curious rectangle. This was the square where Nandi, the Mount of Shiva, the bull, would have been originally placed. Now, that's also gone. I wonder why such deliberate destruction was necessary. Where is this lingam now? When I come outside and put my shoes back on, I'm somehow drawn towards a nearby tree. And as I go near the tree, I find exactly what I wanted. This is the base of the lingam. The base is sitting right here, just outside the chamber, and the cylinder in the center must have been destroyed. It has a square hole inside and has four slots cut, pointing to four different directions. A lingam looking like Mount Kailash would have been set in the middle. Cambodia has thousands of such remnants of a rich past lying in ruins. I try to see if I can somehow find the main cylinder, the lingam. Finding it would be amazing because I've never seen a lingam which looks like Mount Kailash. Perhaps the lingam is stuck inside the debris, the massive stone blocks. I can still feel its presence nearby. Coming back to ancient technology, the blocks you see have multiple holes on them. What is the need for these holes to be drilled on the stone blocks? Archaeologists have a strange theory about these holes, but I will reveal this in my next video. Please let me know your thoughts in the comment section. I am Praveen Mohan. Thanks a lot for watching. Don't forget to subscribe and also click on the bell button to get all the updates. Please give this video a thumbs up and do share it with your friends. I'll talk to you soon. Bye.